The Impact Lounge is the number one YouTube channel for fans of Impact Wrestling.
Make a good lucha thing.
It's just a fact of life.
What's up? It's your boy BQ. Make sure to follow me at BQ Speaks on Instagram and Twitter. Today I want to talk about Killer Kross, how I feel he's being presented in Impact Wrestling, and of course the random attacker segments that debuted him. Side note, Killer Kross just might be my favorite thing in Impact Wrestling right now. I wish I could tell you though that I knew more of his background. I was initially exposed to him during the Global Force Wrestling Amped Anthology. GFW used a lot of video promos to pump up each wrestler and each match, very similar to the build of Austin Aries versus Moose at Slammiversary. Now, everything and everyone felt important, and that was one of the things they did really, really well in regards to the production of Amped. Nobody felt like a jobber. Now, his initial match was against Bobby Roode, and it had a very important feel in the build. But long story short, Roode won in a very dominating fashion, injuring the arm of Kevin Kross, exposing the injury, and winning via tap out. Now, most wrestling matches on TV have gotten away from working a body part and getting the submission win. Now, Roode dominated the match, but the storyline or the storytelling of veteran outsmarting, outworking the young up-and-comer was told masterfully, leading up to Kross wanting to work harder to avenge his loss. Again, this is the lost art in storytelling and properly creating the underdog story. I considered myself a fan of Kevin Kross at this point. I bought into Kevin Kross and even said that I'd love to see him in Impact Wrestling one day. Crazy that that day has come. I'm all about how a wrestler is presented, and right now I'm buying the Killer Kross stock. The random attacker thing started off a little slow. As a matter of fact, I completely forgot about it by the time the second attack had happened. It was just one of those things, kind of like the DCC, where it felt like, okay, this is cool for a second, but it's probably going to be spoiled for us before we ever see it on TV. No need to get excited about it. As weeks passed, the attacks became more random and more interesting. At the time they started inserting Sanjay and Petey Williams, though, I lost interest pretty fast. I figured it was going to lead to one of them being the attacker or being in cahoots with the attacker, or maybe it was both of them. Damn, was I wrong. And Impact did something to counter the spoilers that get leaked by doing the whole entire segment in backstage segments so that the information couldn't get out. What an amazing way to start thinking outside the box and make the show must see. Words that their social media profiles have beaten to death, by the way. Fast forward to the reveal. I'll give credit. There's one guy, he was either on Twitter or Instagram, that called this. I wish I could remember who it was. But he did say Kevin Kross was his guest, and he said it a couple weeks into it. So bravo to that guy. Anyway, I thought the whole security guard thing was really cool and creative. And the fact that they used Petey as the scapegoat, Sanjay has yet to apologize to Petey, by the way, really threw us off the scent of what was going to happen. I'm glad they didn't use some high-profile signing. I'm glad they used someone that not every wrestling fan is necessarily familiar with, although he does compete in Lucha Underground. His upcoming match with Josh Alexander on Impact should be really good as well. Now, in-ring, I really feel that he lives the gimmick. Don Callis had said this, even I said it a while back, that a lot of wrestlers have these, you know, elaborate backstage gimmicks and when they're cutting promos, but once they get into the ring, there's nothing different that separates them from the others. They just become normal wrestlers. Broken Matt Hardy is my best example. He did so much cool shit outside the arena, but once he stepped into the ring, he was Matt Hardy. He wasn't really living the gimmick in his matches other than some comedic biting. Jeff was the same as Brother Nero. Killer Kross has a great entrance, and we haven't seen this kind of opposing monster figure in wrestling for a while. I'm talking like a badass ass kicker. One thing I've noticed with Impact lately is that they don't have the cowardly heels. All the heels are ready for a fight. No one displays this better than Kross, in my opinion. Falaba was his debut match. Falaba is mainly considered a comedy style wrestler on Impact, but we have yet to see anyone manhandle him the way Killer Kross did. There was something really old school about that debut match, I just can't put my finger on it. I loved how we gave Fala the chance to get some offense in too. It was like he was inviting it. That's part of his character and persona that I really like. It's like saying, I know I'm kicking your ass. I'm going to give you a minute to gather yourself, take a few shots at me, see if you get lucky. Later, he takes on Petey Williams and destroys him. He even gave a tired Petey, instead of going for the cover, the opportunity to go for the Canadian Destroyer. I think Killer Kross comes off so polished, and I can envision him going on a massive win streak only to collide with Brian Cage down the road. To me, he's what a heel should be. We are missing this kind of heel competitor in wrestling. And to me, Killer Kross is just another example of Impact Wrestling doing things the right way. Hey, don't forget to leave a thumbs up and subscribe to the channel. Check out the video below for more Impact Wrestling related content. This is the Impact Lounge.